What's up, everybody? Megan Songbringer, day over 180, something like that. Working on this, I finished up this enemy here from yesterday. I renamed him to the Drolete. He's like the Drov, but he's tinier. So he's named the Drolete. A little bit more simple than calling him the small Drov. So I kind of gave these guys more personality by making them stop for a minute, and also they run away. When you get close to them, they run away, and their walk finished up nicely, that walk animation. They shoot these little cannonballs or darts or whatever the heck those are. One kind of thing I want to work on here is that first of all, the darts don't remove themselves when they hit the player, which would be nice, right? Or to have them maybe bounce off the player and hit the ground. That would also be pretty cool. Also, I want to see them like flash or something like that, because they're so small. If I were to run this game in a really, really small window, I would not be able to see those at all. So I need something to be able to attract the eye to them. And I'm thinking a way I can do that is when it launches a projectile or a shot, or whatever you call them, they can flash. So start projectile, there's a start shot, there it is. Start shot. All right, so here's the shot entity. Now I wanna make it so it flashes. I want to put this inside its own block so that I can do an if at some point on it, and I can create variables inside this block and they'll lose their scope afterwards. So I'm gonna go e.render, shot.render.sprite.runAction, and I think I created, yeah, it's just called flash. Created this custom action which just flashes the sprite from regular blending to additive blending and back. So let's give it a duration of like a second to start with. Maybe it should probably be less than that. And we'll do 5 blinks inside that second. All right, let's see if that works. Hey, what's up, Tappy? How you doing, man? How's your day? So I gotta get one of them to shoot at me. Come on. Oh yeah, there we go. Cool, they're flashing a little bit. Yeah, that definitely attracts my eye. I'm thinking a little bit less though. Hey, what's up, Skittle Fiddler? Yeah, I'm doing great too, man. Cool, so you're still working on your game with the one I've been seeing on Twitter? Where did I learn coding? I learned it when I was a kid 20 years ago. I got really interested in games, Skittle Fiddler, when I was in my early teens. When I was 14. So I just started high school, and I was like, man, it'd be so cool if I could make video games. And so I started reading books on the subject. So I read a book about how to learn the C language, and then I read a book on game development. And I did all that, and then I started my own game. I wrote my own game. And I actually published it in 1995 and tried to sell it myself, and actually sold like, I think like 3 copies of the game in an entire year. And that's when I realized, or that's when I started to believe that I wasn't good at marketing. And I also believed at that point I wasn't good at art and never would be good at art. And at that point I couldn't make music, so I hired somebody to make music for the game. So anyways, I've grown a lot since then, but yeah, I started learning with books, so. Nice, cool, you started production? Yes. Awesome, you guys, high five. Yes, it's so cool, that's so sweet to hear, man. Oh, rad. Okay, so I'm just going to give it a little bit less time to flash. And I think I'm also going to give it a this make this a profile property so that I can load this from the profile plist. So some projectiles can have this effect and some won't. Yeah, that's pretty cool to be see them flash really quick. It definitely draws the eye there and gives it more of a feeling that something's going on there. Something important is going on there. So shot.profile.getInt. We're gonna get something there. Hello, Arpeggiator. Arpeggiatura. What's up, man? Welcome to the stream. No, I have not heard of Godot. What's that? Okay, so in the Dart plist, I'm gonna add a property called flash. This is just gonna make it flash when it starts up. Actually, I'm gonna make it a string, so or a number. So this flash, or no, I guess I'll make it a string so that it can be parsed. Yeah, I'll make it a number. So this will be a duration for the flash. So do that same duration there, flash. It's a game engine? Oh, cool. No, I've never heard of it. Okay, so you work inside an editor like this, kind of like Unity, is that right? It's basically a software based. It's not really a game engine, it's more of a game software. Oh, and you can even compile it yourself. That's pretty cool. I mean, this is straight up awesome right here that you can do all these different platforms on it. That's my number one requirement for a game engine. It has to be cross-platform. Look at this. You can even develop for consoles with it. Wow. And they have plans for HTML5. Wow. That's pretty amazing. I don't know, I guess I would, this looks pretty good. Even script. So wait, do you run everything in? Okay, so you run everything in Python. All your code is in Python? That's a great. Oh, or you can integrate C++. That's great. Wow, this sounds like a great game engine to me. I guess it depends on whether you want to work in, whether you prefer to work in something like this, like a game editor or not. If you're used to working with like Unity or whatever, you're going to love something like this. If you're used to coding everything and using sort of more of a code-based game engine like CocoStudiX, then you're probably not going to be happy with it, but that totally depends on you. In fact, I'm going to make it flash straight up in the creation method for any entity. So in when it creates a being, you can load the flash number get profile dot get no get float for flash. Default value is going to be 0 for this. So by default, every entity does not flash when it starts up. Okay, so if it's alive, Then we'll do this flashing. This is pretty cool to move this into the actual. Basically, what I've done here is I've made this data driven. So that's really awesome. And I can do like a default here. So this is the duration flash, and then we'll divide flash by 0.1 to get the number of flashes we're going to see in here. So yeah, that'll work. Okay. So yeah, right after this, I'm going to make a new enemy. This is going to be a jumping enemy, kind of like the spider from Legend of Zelda, where it would just jump to different spots. I always thought that spider enemy was really difficult. Okay, cool. So that's things flashing. Let's do another test where... Let's do one more test where we actually increase the amount of flash. So set that flash to like a whole 2 seconds and see if the darts or whatever those things are, if they continue flashing for that whole 2 seconds. That'll kind of prove that it's data driven. Yeah, cool. That thing is flashing the whole time. Sweet. That's working. Good. So we'll undo that change there. And I think I'd like to them to flash a little bit less often. So let's move that down to 1.618. That's going to be a little less than a tenth of a second, or I mean a little more than a tenth of a second per flash. So it'll be, in fact, I might want to put that to 0.2. I don't know. Yeah, that's better. Just flashes for a second. In fact, I wanted to a little less flash. Give it so it'll feel more like a muzzle flare, not a muzzle flare, but like the thing is hot. So we'll do maybe a half second instead of 0.7 seconds on it. Hello, Hyrule Spy. Yeah, there we go. Cool. Now it just has a tiny little flash when it starts. All right, the next thing I want to do, and this is the last thing I want to do before I move to the next enemy, is when I get hit by one of these, I want them to remove themselves. So you know what? I got an idea of how to do this. So I can program this into the behavior tree, something like this. Actually, I'll write the behavior before I do this, so that way you can see what's going on. I like to do that. Shot. So if a shot, this is what it'll be like. Sequence remove because collision. If collision remove, that's it. That's really all there is to it. In fact, I don't think I need either of these, but I'll test that in a second. So, yeah, this is what I want to happen. If there's a collision, remove. That's really all there is to it. So if it hits anything that it's meant to collide with, that it has its mask for, then, yeah, we already have the word collision, too. That's great. Cool. Okay, so I can go to the system now and hook up a new word into the behavior tree. Called collision on if. So else if subtype equals K behavior collision, we're gonna run a test on the with the current mask and everything. We wanna do like if, well, actually we should get an ID on what we're colliding with. We'll go call the collision system. Let's get collision. And we want to use the current entity. Yeah, I guess we just want to use this convenience method here with the int, which is just E, and the mask, which is E.collision.mask. Well, that's pretty easy. All right, so if we're going to return if ID is greater than zero. There we go. There's one inefficiency to this, and that's that we're calling this twice because the collision engine is already called get collision. And here now I'm inside the AI system, and that's calling get collision as well. But I've already done a lot of optimization on this get collision, so I'm really not scared about that right at this point. I really shouldn't even think about optimization until after I've got it the way I want it anyway. So let's see if this works. If this works, what'll happen is when the projectile hits the player, it will remove itself. Okay, it didn't work. What's up, Zed Epsilon? Welcome back to the stream, man. Okay, so I don't know why it didn't work. Let's figure out. Set a breakpoint here and make sure it's hitting that to start with. Shoot me, do it, do it. Okay, it looks like we've got a collision call, or we've hit this breakpoint. Oh, that's probably because it's just creating it at this point right now. So let's see if that's correct. So we would have a profile of Dart. Okay, that's great, good. Got Dart. This is a Dart that we're looking at, which is to be expected. All right, now we're gonna go get the collision. So let's step into this and make sure everything here is working right. Yeah, okay, so it has a position, has a collision. Let's see what that stuff is. Current pause is about 317, 187. Collision should have a size. We've got 120 by 120 or 12 by 12. Got a good category, mask, damage, everything. Good. Okay. Let's step in here and wait, what's the mask that we're looking for? 12288. Yeah, this should be fine. Yeah, and I don't think I can go through every single one of these. Yeah, so this is a tricky one to debug because I don't want to go through hundreds of different entities trying to look for collisions right now. I think really the best way to try and debug that would be to use my intuition or to just debug it later and get to creating this new jumper type enemy first. So let's let this run. Instant death. Let's try one more thing. Let's try setting the entities, the dart speed to 0. And these guys don't want to shoot as much. Shoot, there. Huh. Or maybe it's, is it a horizontal type thing? Yeah, doesn't matter.
Weird.
Weird.
Okay. Well,
Okay,
that's not
well,
working.
but
But
I'm gonna let my
I'm
brain
gonna
rest
let
on
my
that
brain rest
one.
on that one.
I do think
I
that
do think that
these are
the
neither of these are
neither
method necessary. Yeah, I'm just gonna debug all that later. I don't know why that didn't work. Really? Do I sound like a robot right now? Hello, hello. Huh. It's fine now? Okay. All right, yeah, I'm just gonna skip all this. Do this later. Figured out. Yo, Alex Pito, what's up, man? What's up? Okay, let's create this new guy. So we got that guy's finished for now. Want to create a this guy's gonna be pretty small. Maybe let's do I'm gonna do 48 by 48 for his image. And today I'm going to start with a totally gray square and work on his mechanics before I actually work on his art. So I'm thinking like it's a he's like a square like this for now. Three hours sleep. Dang, man. You're a superhuman. Meladen, what's up, man? Welcome to the stream today. Confetti. Confetti. So this guy's like some kind of jumper enemy, and I like to keep the names of the enemies sort of a little bit intuitive, 'cause it helps me, and also I think down the road it'll help people when they're referencing certain enemies on maybe wikis or whatever. So call this one a jitter. Yeah, of course. Thanks for following. So this is gonna be a jitter's idle. Maybe it's a jitter like that. Sleepbringer. Oh. I'm honored. I'm honored to be your sleepbringer. So first thing I'm doing here is like I said, I've just drew a gray square for this enemy to start with. That's going to show you guys that I'm not trying to make any art for this yet. I'm just trying to create the behavior first, and then I'm going to finish up with the art. So this guy's going to work a lot like the hoppers that are already in there. Jitter idle 0. Let's get the jitter hooked up. Actually, I'm gonna go. Was gonna check this code in, but there's no need. So he's a lot like the hopper. So I'm gonna take the hopper behavior and create a jitter behavior. And then I'm gonna copy the hopper property list. Okay, we've got jitters. Let's use the right behavior. Hook up that graphic. And now all I gotta do is hook it up into the world. I think these guys should be more like, yeah, easier than the jitters. So this is kind of an increasing difficulty, starting with blobs, then moving to the jitter, then the drill leap. That ought to do for now. Okay, so now we gotta go wander around and try and find these guys. Oh, I do wanna go and change up their properties so they're actually gonna hurt the player. So we need to give them a collision. Sort of like the, I guess the default. No, I want them to have custom collision. So I want to mimic like the droid bat. That would be a good collision to copy. All right, so the collision type is foe. And we do one damage if they hit. Hey, what's up, Slow Excellence? All right, let's see what happens. Let's try and find these guys. They're going to be, I'm looking for gray squares. Oh, there's some right on this screen. Cool. All right, sweet. We got gray squares jumping around. They're obviously too big. I wanted these guys to be smaller. So let's see if we can get hurt by them. Yeah, we can get hurt. Let's see if we can get jumped on by one of these guys. Yeah, cool. All right. Awesome. We have a working behavior. That was really quick. Cool. All right, so the next thing is going to be to dial in the proportions and then draw this guy. And I'm going to take a quick break. Be right back. Hey, what's up, Duty Bob? Welcome back to the stream, man. Oh, yeah. I hear you, man. That was too big. Way too big. What was that before? Before we have a size of about 30 pixels wide. Let's take it down to 20, 20-ish. And oh, I want them to move faster. I think that's in here. I think the move is part of its jumping, how fast it jumps. So let's see if that's true. So this should be smaller and you should jump farther. Yeah. Okay, they're still too big. And I want them to jump even farther, and I want them to jump less. Like they stay there for a minute. So going to the jitter's behavior. Okay, so this is a pretty simple thing, right? All it has is this sequence to hop, and it's based on this random timing or whatever. Let's set this timer higher. Oh, the jump is here. That's the distance of the jump. So I set his move speed up to 200, and I don't think that is going to actually affect how far it jumps. Yeah, it's still jumping the same distance. So I was changing the wrong thing there. In fact, this could have a move of 0, 0. I think. Let's see if it still can jump with the zoo with 0, 0. Yeah. Okay. Oh, cool. And they still have sort of a deceleration too. All right. So let's get them to jump farther. That's gonna be a lot farther. Yeah, I mean, let's try doubling it. Whoa. Gotta keep them jumping on the screen. That would help. Check it out, a fly got caught on. That was awesome. So the flies, they get attracted to living things. That's pretty far. It's jumping a little bit too far, I think. Set that down to 100. Yeah, 90 would probably be a good one too. Let's do 90. Okay, and I want them to be smaller. Yeah, that's pretty good. 90 is really excellent amount of jumping. Now, what I'll do later on, what I'll do is I'll work on the behavior so that it doesn't actually jump off the screen as much. Like we can easily make them so they jump. If like the angle of the jump can be determined based on the where they are on the screen. So like if they're on the bottom of the screen, they're never going to try and jump farther south. But I think they're ready to animate now. Yeah, let's do this. Let's do this. Wait, was that about the right proportion? Was thinking those are about the right size. Yeah, that's about how big they need to be. I'm thinking this is going to be a thing with wings, sort of like an insect, a big insect. It gets a cube, jumpy cube of death. What's up, Letter Thief and Nano? Yo, so you got here right when I'm about to draw this thing. Right, so let's get a new layer. I'm still drawing with my mouse because I ordered a soldering iron so I can try and fix my graphics tablet. Okay, here's the first frame. I want this guy to be sort of an orange insect. It's going good, man. Yeah. I'm kicking ass. I'm making a lot of enemies this week. Yesterday when I was using it broke down so much that I couldn't even make art at all. It broke down so often I couldn't do like anything. So I either gotta buy a new one or fix this one, and I'm thinking this one can be fixed. I've read some stuff online about how they can be fixed. There you go. Yeah, so I saw this guy. It's only where it connects, right? The connector for the USB cable is the only problem with it. It's the connection is so janky or whatever, because I dropped it one time, so the connection doesn't quite, the female and the male, they don't get along. It's a sad story. Okay, so I'm gonna make this box here one more pixel big. Get a good outline, right? There. We got 15 pixels on the right, 17 on the left, so I'm gonna move this thing. Here we go. This little gray square is crucial. It's showing me where to put stuff. Okay, so I want like an orangey insect. Something with eyes. Yes, we could write a whole book about them. Eklof, what's up, man? What's up? Okay. I'm drawing an orangish insecty type enemy. Want him to be able to have these like grayish wings. That flutter when he jumps. So he's like a jumping enemy. He's got these like, it's not quite a grasshopper, it's not a spider. So here's this kind of an outline of what I was thinking. something like this. I'm gonna go and, you know, of course make this better, but something like about like that. Let's see what that looks like with its proportions now. So I haven't done any shading and I haven't done any details on this thing, but I think this is about what he's gonna look like. How much time does the player spend in the overworld? I guess it would depend on the player. But really, you would think of like Legend of Zelda, and that's about how much time I want the game to actually spend, or the player to spend about, you know, like how much time would you spend in the Legend of Zelda's overworld? It is jumping off screen. So they're a bit too bright for sure. Yeah, well, yeah. It's pretty quick. You know, I guess it's quick because I'm mostly data driven, so I can create this stuff pretty fast. Like I just created this here by cop. I already had the hopper done. So the hopper, I based this entire thing on the hopper. So that's what's, you know, so quick about it, I guess. So overall, it's just way too dark or way too bright. So let's turn down its brightness. Start with like negative. -15. See how bright that is. Everything changes when you put it in the game. So that's why I do this. I've seen some other artists. Yeah, it's definitely a perk for sure. That's one thing that actually does go very quickly. Yeah. Yes, that too. Yeah, workflow for sure. Yeah, and that one thing that's allowing me to do this so quickly is that I've got this script which runs every time I run the game. It runs this script which rebuilds all my sprite sheets. So it just loops over every single file that I have and then runs Texture Packer to automatically update it. And so that's really, really handy as well. So normally I would have to go back to Texture Packer and then republish the sprite sheet every time I did that, but then I realized I could do that with a script, and oh, saved so much time doing that. And then, of course, see now, okay, yeah, now they're looking, I think they should be a tiny bit darker than that, just a tiny bit, though. Yeah, it's super handy. And then another one of the most handy things, these two things here, yeah, this, the property list to load all of their animations and everything. Sound effects, sprite sheets, attributes. This is incredibly handy right here. And then also, this is probably more handy, is having all of the AI written with the behavior tree. So the behavior trees are awesome because like I used to have to write all my AI as separate functions per enemy. Nice. And so this is just so handy to not have to write more code for every single AI or enemy. This is great to just have basically all of the code for artificial intelligence is data driven. That is so handy. Nice, Nana. What kind of game do you want to create? What genre? Yeah, definitely. Yeah, there's a good article I saw on it from Wizards Duel. They were explaining it. If you guys haven't seen Wizards Duel, man, this looks really fun. Here you go. Entity system, data-driven versus object-driven. This would be a great article, Lighter Thief, to pass on to your coder. Have them take a look at that. It might inspire him. But this kind of explains how I would do it too. This explains the difference between entity systems at the code level and entity systems at the data level. Oh, cool. Strategy horror-ish. Nice. Nice. Right on. Awesome, man. Well, keep us posted. I want to hear about it, and I'm sure other people here on the stream want to hear about it too. So, as you start to get screenshots and stuff, please share. So I just took down the brightness a little bit more. So if anybody's just joining the stream, the way I do this art is I iterate it. So what I started with was a gray square, and I created a behavior for this enemy, and now I've created an outline sort of for the art. And now I'm dialing in the brightness. So basically what the first thing I dialed in was the proportion. I wanted to make sure it was just big enough. Now I'm making sure it's just bright enough. And then finally I'll go and actually shade it and then animate it finally after that. So it still needs to be a little darker, I think. Sweet. Looking forward to it. Yeah, any darker and it's probably gonna get too dark. Especially when the shadows and stuff are added in. Just want to delete that other one to make sure that it's using the right one too. Okay, sweet. Let's make this guy look better. I want him to have eyes, and I want these wings to be transparent, and I want him to hit the ground so these legs are not going to be visible the whole time. And then I want to shade the rest, so. Oh, I haven't seen Night at the Museum. Oh, wait, no, yeah, I have, yeah. Okay, cool. Rad. So these wings, get them to be transparent. Start off by checking out how transparent that is. Like that's 40%. Let's see how that looks in the game. Yeah, definitely, Tappy. Please. Yeah, share. That's definitely one of the reasons I do these live streams. I want to connect with you guys. I want to see what you guys are working on and it's cool. Oh yeah, 40%. Maybe 50. Maybe 50 or 60 actually. Let's move it all the way to 60 to start with. Yeah, 60 is a bit too much, actually. So 50. 50 it is. 50 is a nice number anyways. Easy to remember. Okay, so I want to turn these this brownish part right here into eyes. Delivery girl. Oh, I think I saw this on Twitter. Or you were mentioning it or something. Oh, nice. What's she delivering? Sweet. Yeah, cool. Nice work. What's that? So what's the concept again for the game? Nice. Oh yeah. An assassin working for a company who's using a restaurant as a front. Cool. Awesome. Awesome, man. I can't wait to see more. And I'm really looking forward to seeing you guys make this game and seeing how you guys do, and I'm rooting for you guys, you know? Oh, whoops. How long have I been drawing this layer? It's dial a hit. Wow. Oh. Wow. Okay, so I drew all those. On the wrong layer. Everything, really? Just put these layers together. Ah, cool. okay, so it's top. Oh, it's this kind of top down. Oh, right, nice. Yeah, totally. It reminds me also of this one I just saw. Man, I mean, not just saw, it was released like a year, 3 years ago or something. Some kind of really, really cool concept. They had like a. I'll try and, I'm trying to remember that. The name of this game is cool. Yeah, nice, man. So as hues get darker, they tend to be more bluish, right? So I'm trying to play with some hue shifts here. I think I maybe shifted the hue a bit too much there. And that's almost back to what it was. Right on. Good luck, man. Good luck. What's your process for choosing numbers? The yellow should be shifting towards orange red. Well, this is already an orange. I want it to shift towards. Really? As it gets darker? I thought things that were in shadow shifted more towards blue, but I don't know. Lighter thief would know. Oh, okay. All right. All right. Well, good luck. Okay, so they would shift to blue, but in this case via the red purple route. So yeah. Oh. So okay, so they shift. And so what, help me, is there some easy way I can remember that? Like why would it shift through red purple? Is that just the closer path? Or do things just never shift through gr the greenish, yellowish, bluish one or cyan? Okay, so I'm gonna do that over then. Instead of it being this hue for that shadow, I'll shift it more reddish. That's a bit dark. The darker hue? Huh. Yeah, but how is that a darker hue or a lighter hue? I guess it kind of is a lighter or darker hue. I've never thought of hues as being dark in themselves, but they are. This yellow, this green, this cyan, these are all really brighter, lighter hues. And then we got this deep blue, this sort of deep purple, and a pretty deep red. Okay. There you go. Thank you. That's a breakthrough for me. Thanks to you guys once again coming through, teaching me stuff. Yeah, thank you. Now I owe you a beer. If you're ever in the Bay Area, like for GDC or whatever, I owe you a beer. Pretty much owe everybody a beer. right, cool. I want some of these though to be a little brighter. Like, let's try really highlighting up this purple. Yeah. If it goes well, you're gonna have to be at all of them. E3, GDC. Launch party. All right, last thing I want to do on top of this is a little bit of, I'm gonna erase out a little, some like vein type lines. That's pretty good. Yeah. Yeah. Cool. Sweet. It's weird how some things are not quite correct physically or whatever, but it works visually. Tricks of the eye or whatever. Okay, this guy's looking better. Let's see what he looks like in the game now, and then I'll make him animate. Whoa, they're like crazy bright now. That orange, at least, is, I think, a bit too bright. I can't hurt him. They're invincible. So, all of this orange was a bit too bright. Just tone it down a bit. Oh, yeah. Okay. Right? A way to separate them. Yeah, that's definitely some tr thank you. Thank you for ch sharing that. Never use black gray for shading. Thank you. Oh man, seriously, like I need to hear a lot of this kind of stuff because this is the newest skill for me is art. I'm still learning a lot about it. I consider myself a pretty much a beginner at this point. And so I'm really trying to get better because I want Songbringer to be awesome. I see that. Wow, it still looks too bright. It's so weird. So weird. Ah, cool. Oh, sweet. Oh, I didn't know you were prime. So you're primarily an artist? Awesome. Okay, it doesn't make sense that I made it that dark and now it looks right, but it does. And now it looks right in the game. Okay, cool. We'll keep it there. All right, let's animate this guy. It's frame zero. We don't need this gray box anymore. All right, so frame one, I want him to maybe lift his wings up a little bit. Lucarno, what's up, man? Did the Thanks for joining the stream again. Did the color j change when they jump? That's a really good question. I know it changes right when they start because it's indicating they were asleep, right? They start off. Yeah, I don't think it's changing. It might have just been the shader that it's getting. It's like if I move the player far over here. You're gonna notice the right side of the screen get really dark, so it might have been that. Ah, okay. Well, you taught me a lot about color theory today, just with that. Oh, the sleep. Yeah. Okay. Yeah, I don't know that sleep effect. I might be changing that up at some point because the sleep effect makes them. Oh, sorry guys, I reset the chat window. The sleep effect makes them kind of look, they almost blend in too much with the background at first. And I don't really think that they really need that sleep effect anymore, so I'm probably will change that up. Oh, cool. Oh, I'd love to see that. Yeah. Okay, so I'm just working on an idle animation here where he's just sitting on the ground and his wings move a little bit. So I'm gonna do a frame where his one wing's up, another frame where the other wing's up. All right. And I'm gonna add some sort of like highlights to his eyes and stuff. So it looks like he's maybe moving his eyes slightly, and that's creating a different reflection off of the his retinas and stuff. And I'm also moving this slight texturing on his body, so that he looks a little different. Okay, so let's put that together, see if we got a good idle animation. Yeah, so that brightness in his eyes is a bit too much. And this is all going a little bit too fast, so I'm going to set it down to like 0.2. Yeah, okay. If it didn't look so Christmassy with that, it would look better. So I'm going to work on that first. So I don't like how it's just like really, it's getting too bright. And it would be nice if things kind of, it just looked more like he was actually shifting the position of his eye more than actually brightening things up too much. Okay, let's see what that looks like. Okay, this was a little bit too much brightness there. Yeah, that's better, but still, yeah, that one bright, that one right there. This one right here, I'm gonna make this pixel a little darker green. So it looks like we're seeing the side of his eye turn. Yeah, that's a lot better. Only, okay, there's one part I don't like, and that's this. Maybe when he turns, you could also get rid of this pixel here. And also that pixel there. Yeah, cool. Okay, now he's looking like now he looks like he's alive. It's alive. Okay, I want to put all these to 0.1 seconds too, so this whoops. So this exports correctly. Right, now I gotta change up his property list. Include all those frames. And the delay per frame. 0.2 looked like it was working all right there. Oh, looks like it just randomly crashed. It's weird, they're not doing their idle animations at all. Why wouldn't they be doing their idle animation? You should just be doing that. Okay, if they don't ever jump, return off their jump and see if they idle like they should now. Yeah, nothing. Okay, let's make sure that it's actually exported 4 frames and they're different. Yeah, they're cool. Jitter, idle, 0 through 3. Okay, there's that. So every single entity in the game by default runs its idle animation. It's spelled correctly. It looks like it's loading it correctly. In fact, if I set this to 5 frames, it should just break the build. Yeah, so we definitely got the right number of frames. I guess it could be the delay. It's not helping either. So weird. What's up, babe? Well, okay, you know what? I'm going to start with creating another animation because I think if it runs another animation, it probably will revert back to running its idle animation. So maybe that's the problem. It's that it never quite starts its animations. But I should fix that. Okay. But anyways, let's start with creating this jump animation. So we got a new file, jitter jump. Jitter jump. Jumpity jump, jump. Okay, this is gonna be an easy one. He jumps in the air. He's got these long little tendrils. That's cool. About 5 pixels. Yeah, and then his wings just flap the whole time. And I think they'll get a little bit less transparent too. Sweet. Thank you, Tappy. Understanding Color by Blender Guru. Sweet. Nice. I love these. There's something I freaking love art tutorials. They're so sweet. Cheers, man. I'm sure this is gonna help. The one that I learned from one time, I learned from this guy a little bit. I watched his YouTube videos. I forget his name right now, but I think he was on this. Anyways, you already know. You already know, man. All right, so these wings are going to get like blurred out a bit and really transparent. So, I'm going to erase them a bit, like maybe 50% more. Oh, cool. Well, what was his name? Oh, Sykra. Yeah, Sykra. Sykra taught me a lot. I watched a lot of his YouTube videos. He's got a lot of tutorial videos. So Sykra's YouTube. I think he's got some like, yeah. Oh, here's the color. Yeah, here's the one I learned. What's up, Tefin? Yo. We're talking about color and learning art and stuff right now. So yeah, how to choose colors that work. This is the one that taught me a lot about how to choose colors. But yeah, and I did a bunch of his tutorials as well. But yeah, here's one. I recommend this guy for sure. I'll give you a link to his Grubuck, what's up? Howdy howdy. All right, and I think these are gonna. I think these would blur a little bit more, so they would have like a little bit of like, I want to see some motion blur almost. So I'm gonna go draw with even less opacity. Yeah, man. Maybe there's a golden nugget in there. Okay, now I like these frame 1 and 2 already we have, so I'm gonna get those in. about the same position. All right, and then do the same kind of blurring-ish thing to the wings. Hopefully this looks good. I'm probably gonna have to do this at a really fast, like fast frame rate to make these wings look like they're kind of flapping really, really hard. So anyway, they just joined the stream. I'm just drawing this new enemy. This guy is called the Jitter. He's a little like jumping bug thing. The inspiration for this is, of course, always coming from Zelda. This comes from the spider enemy. So the spider was that thing that jumped and like just jumped to different random parts of the screen on the overworld. So that's kind of what this enemy is. He's just a guy that jumps around randomly. That's it. Okay, let's see what that looks like. Oh, maybe I'll make him so he even hovers a bit, like changes his Y position a bit. Now, Photoshop's not going to let me set the frame rate any lower than 0.1, or it will, but it won't actually show it. This guy's going to be funny. Okay, so let's add some up and down. Yeah, so these two frames here, we'll move him down or up. And then these two frames down. So he gets kind of a hovering type effect too. Yeah. Cool. All right, see what this looks like. Export, render video, jump. Okay, so we should have 8 frames of a jump animation. I'm just gonna verify that. Jitter jump 0 through 7. Perfecto. Eight, and I'm gonna start with 0.05, so that's gonna be twice the speed of most animations. And then we gotta go to his behavior, and when he jumps, he actually animates that too. So animate jump. All right, and that might fix them too, so they have correct idle animations. We'll see. Oh. Unrecognized behavior type animate. What? Oh. It might be that I named it the actual. Might be that's a reserved word. Yeah, there we go. Now they got their animations going. Sweet. Yeah, and they need shadows. Why don't they have shadows? It'll make them so much better. Shadow, yes. All right. One thing that would really help these guys is if they jumped on the screen all the time. So that can work. Cool. Yeah, totally. They're a big inspiration of mine. Sword and Sorcery is probably one of the more primary inspirations. Thank you, man. Thank you. It can get better. The trees don't look that good yet. I haven't actually finished up with the trees, but. All right, man. Good night. Good night, Tabby. Thanks for joining the stream, man. Have a great night and good luck with your game. I can't wait to hear more about it. I think they're cool. See you, man. I'm gonna turn on screen capture so I can see if what's going on with their shadow when they jump, because I'm not quite seeing it. It's faster than my eye. Yeah, so their shadow, that's not cool. Why is their shadow so far? I thought I got their shadows to work so that they were on the ground. Maybe they are. I don't know. Okay, let's get them so they can just jump on the screen. Actually, yeah, I'm gonna write these two down. So, the idle. What was the other thing that I did today? Oh yeah. Okay. Let's start with this jitter jumping only on the screen thing. In the system for running, let me check my time here. I'm starting to get hungry already. 1:39. Okay. We got a bit of time. We got 20 minutes at least. So the system for running jumps, let's call it, is in sh system. I know so many ideas, right? So many bugs too. These are bugs. All these are like bugs or things I want to improve. These two. And then these are all ideas right here. So there's so much left to do in this game. This kind of overwhelms me even looking at it. I shouldn't be looking at that. All right. right. Yeah. Too many bugs. Okay, behave. We got the behavior to jump, which should be. Oh, that's one thing. I want to improve that too. Oh yeah, they should be parsed. Behavior trees. This is a bug I've kind of run into where if I use the same word as a behavior word, it kind of doesn't work. Thanks, Steve. Yeah, pizza and polka music. Some of these ideas are great, right? It sounds like a feature to me. Perfect. Thank you. Yeah, some of these bugs are going to be features for a while. Look at this one, talking tree when you eat some cactuses. That would be rad, right? The trip mine, that's going to be a rad upgrade for the bombs at some point. The Game Genie Cave, remember the Nintendo Game Genie? So there'll be a cave you can go into where you can enter in Game Genie codes. Yeah, there's so much, so many good ideas. Lawnmower, I don't even know what that is right now. All right, jump. Okay, so we need to be able to choose an angle. Here's where it randomly chooses the angle right there. So we just want to make sure that this angle is on the screen, right? So if there, I think the best thing to do would be to create a range of angles that are going to work. Yeah. Jib is player two, totally. Yeah, that's going to be a nice feature, right? So co-op mode has always been planned, right? And it was you were going to play as this character called Vel. She's the female character. But I think I might just start with just playing, making Jib playable. So if you're player two, you can be Jib. And then later on, I can add Vel being playable as like a free upgrade. So I don't know. Well, it'll be fun. No matter what, I think it'd be fun to be player two and not quite be in control of the game, but like still be able to help out player one. Yeah. Okay, so this is where if I can choose an angle, it's gonna work, right? Okay, I got an idea. We can find out the quadrant of the player, and then just like choose an angle based on that. So, oh yeah, okay, this is actually pretty easy. So we'll start with float angle 0. And then this will be angle plus equals. So m pi times 2 would be 360 degrees. We only want to do 90 degrees now. So it's just m pi over 2. So there, that's a random 90 degree angle. And then now we just want to add 90 or add up to 270 degrees based on the quadrant. So I know area already has a get quadrant. Oh yeah, we can do this. Autoref area equals world. Wait, do we already have the area? Is that a bug? Maybe not. What's that? Unused variable. Okay. Yeah, all right. So we can get the current player's current area. Get quadrant is just if you pass it the X and Y tile. Right, let's do a better method or an easier call method of area. Get quadrant. Oh, it's a private anyways. Okay, we'll make a private get quadrant. Based on a position. In a lot of video games, the default character is a guy. If you want to play as a female character, it's not easy. Often you have to pay. It's not fair. Cool, good thought. Good thought, Locarno. I'll definitely consider this. That was the original plan anyways, right? Cool. I'll check this article out later on. Yeah, that'd probably be more fair anyways. So we'll pass in an integer vector too. Or three. This one. So I started compiling. Now I'm gonna go back to this get quadrant function and create another one. Yeah, so I'm grabbing the tile position. Based on that. And then returning this get quadrant based on that x, y. There, so just simple convenience method. To make that easier here in system. We'll switch that, switch area, get quadrant based on the entity's current position. Right? So all we're doing here is determining the angle. Okay, so we got case southeast to begin with. In the southeast quadrant, we always want to jump. I think angle 0 is straight to the right. I could totally be wrong about that. So, but anyways, if that is true, angle 0 is to the right. Now, you know what? Let's confirm that first. Let's set that angle always to 0. Yeah. So these guys are going to jump at angle 0, and we'll see what that is. Then I can do this. So each one of these quadrants is just going to have a simple offset that will always keep it within that range. And I thought I compiled this already. Yeah, so Xcode compiles so slow when Open Broadcaster is also running because it takes a lot of CPU. It says 20% here, but that's really more like 50% of one of the CPUs or one of the cores. Yeah, great. Okay, so they all jumped exactly to the right. So that was correct. Correct guess. Okay, so southeast is negative 90 or 270. No, 180 will be the start. So, yeah. Angle plus equals 180, which is pi. Okay, southwest is going to be I think it's just going to be another quarter pi. Right, so southwest, we want to start here, which is 270 to start. Yeah, okay, so that's southwest. Northwest, we want to start at zero. That's really easy. And then northeast, we wanted to add 90. Okay, let's see if this works. If this works, then the jumpers will always jump on the screen. Closer to the screen. Closer to the middle. Somewhere. Sort of closer to the middle. Or random still. I don't know if it's working. Yeah, I don't know. Maybe I didn't add right. What's this? Angle plus equals 0 to 1 times a quarter pi or half pi. Yeah, half pi. That's right. Two halves of a pi make pi. Four halves make a whole circle. What did I do wrong? Well, let's set a breakpoint. We'll figure it out. Every time they jump, we'll set this breakpoint and we'll hit it. We can see what's going on with the actual math. All right, cool. We've hit the first breakpoint. Yo, what's up, Taco? It's Bimort. Welcome to the stream, guys. I'm working on this new enemy here. These little orange bug-like creatures. They just jump, and they hurt you if you touch them. And I'm working on a little thing now to make them so they always jump on the screen. And I think I've got the right concept here for how to do that, but I'm just trying to dial in the code. So I set a breakpoint. I'm trying to figure it out. Okay, so we've got angle 0 to start with. Yeah, of course, please. Yeah, feel free to post links anytime. The only people I don't like to post links are total trolls, but they're the kind of people I would ban anyways, and none of you guys are the people I would ban anyways. So please feel free to post links anytime you want. Okay, so I don't know which guy this is. You know what? This actually should be, I'm gonna stop this and do only one of these guys at a time. This will make this debugging process a lot easier. So I'm gonna do one and then amount 0. So that just guarantees there's only one of them. Awesome. Oh, that's great. The seventh element, is that what he is? Like the fifth element, but this is the seventh one. Oh, okay, I gotta watch it later with sound. I can't play videos with sound on my video because they get flagged by YouTube. So I'll check it out later. I'll have a better laugh. Thanks, Taco. Okay, now that we got one of these guys on the screen, it'll be way easier to debug and figure out which one he is and what angle he's gonna be at, what quadrant he's in, and all that. So, all right, there he is in the top right. It's creepy. He's looking creepy already. Okay, so he should be in the quadrant north east. Okay, and it gave us southeast. Well, no wonder. No freaking wonder. All right. All right, Light of Thief, man. Good night, man. Have a great sleep. See you next time. Okay, let's do that again. So, where are we now? I'm gonna start this over. So, you need to pay closer attention because the get quadrant in here is obviously the one of the problems. So we should be in the northeast. The pause that got passed in is 337 on the X, 104 on the Y. That doesn't seem right. Me start that over. That doesn't seem right. 104. Should be more like one. It looked like it was up at 180 or so. The whole screen's about 200 or so. So yeah, he should be way higher than that. We got behavior jump. This should be. I should have the profile name. Hopper. Oh, that's a hopper. Oh. Okay, we gotta turn off all the hoppers momentarily so they're not messing with this. All right, cool. Here's the jitter. Awesome. And his position. Yeah, 180. That's much better. Hello, Yumi. Yes, I do use an Apple mouse. It's so old and so barely working. Like if you can see the threads on it it's got exposed wires and everything. It's so horrible. I don't know if you can see that, but yeah, it's barely hanging on by a thread. I definitely need a new get a whole new keyboard, mouse, and graphics tablet. I got some old equipment, except for my computer. My laptop's awesome. I love my laptop. Okay, 330, 180. That's what your phone charging cable looks like? Oh man, I've seen so many phone charging cables like that too. Yeah, I think I have one too, like that. Yeah, thank you. Thank you. Yeah, if you got any recommendations on good keyboards or mouses, I'm all ears. All right, we should be able to see that. Northeast, good. Okay. So, what do we got for an angle? Angle should be zero. Now the angle is 1.57, which should put it. Oh, I could be wrong about that. It could be going this way. I forgot. I don't know if it's. Yeah, that's one thing I should test. Right? That's how it works, man. Just one day. I know what you mean. Okay, so I'm gonna set the angle to 1.5 so I can see which direction that's going in. I forgot to check if it's if that's up or down. Oh, and we don't want to add anything to it either. There. So there, this is going to be, if that's straight up, then this math needs a change. That would explain it. Yeah, it was up. No wonder. Okay, well, that totally explains everything. Let's redo all this math. Okay, so southeast, we want 270. So that's going to be m pi plus m pi over 2. Did I try Appcode? No, I did not. Yeah, I don't I'm not really a fan of JetBrains myself. And well, I shouldn't say that. JetBrains is actually really cool. It's just that I'm already so comfortable with Xcode and using it that changing IDEs would be just a so take so much time. So I only got so much time to make this game. I literally have until December, and that's when all my funds are gonna run out from the Kickstarter. So I gotta haul ass as it is. There's really no time to try out other tools at this point. So maybe after I do this game, maybe I'll try out some other IDEs. Maybe there's some better ones out there. But what is it that you love? What is it that you love about Epcode? So Southwest is 90, 180. Yeah, Southwest is 180. Yeah, and I'm already learning Vim, right? Yeah, I've learned a lot of Vim actually. I'm actually getting way more comfortable with Vim. The one thing I really learned recently was how to find stuff. You know, there's a I'm actually getting so used to Vim now that I tried Nano the other day and I couldn't even use it anymore. I'm like, oh my gosh, I can't even. It's crazy. Okay, so Northwest. Northwest would be Northwest. It's just yeah, so it would be 90, 180. 270? I already did 270. I must have done southeast wrong. Right? Northwest. 90, 180. That would create. Oh, no. Yeah, 270. That would create any angle. Yeah, okay, that's definitely northwest. What's up, Fung? Welcome, man. Okay, so southeast. That's gonna be just 90. Yeah, southeast is not just 90. And then this quadrant is southwest. So southwest is nothing. Okay. And then northeast would be. Ninety, 180. Oh, it's just 180. Right, let's hope this works. Fung man, welcome to the stream. I'm making this jumping guy. He's a jumping insect-like enemy. And now I'm trying to make him so he always jumps on the screen. So I'm just setting a. Got a he's kind of he's got a random based on 90 degrees he can jump, and it just depends on his quadrant. Yeah, cool, he jumped on the screen. Yeah, nice. Sweet. Okay, I want to see a little more randomness that kind of goes beyond the angle. What's up, Dr. Razum? So I'm thinking like m pi over 4 times a half. So he has a chance to jump a little bit more randomly. No, I'm actually maybe just m pi over 4. So there. He does have a chance that he could jump a little bit off of that 90 degrees, so it would be more like that, each time. So that'll just make him a little bit more natural and not seem like he's so programmed. Hopefully. Yeah, this is great. I'll make him jump a lot more often so we can see him just jump over all over the screen. Yeah, slow excellence. An F after a number in C and C++ makes it a float. So, yeah, the compiler just knows that that number is a float, and it automatically creates it that way or casts it that way. Whoa. Okay, how did he jump off the screen if, yeah. Dang, so there's a couple jumps where it's just not working. Oh, or it could be that his quadrant is just wrong. What do you mean? Try him one more time, see what happens the second time we run it. I think it might have been that he actually got off screen. Oh, damn. Okay, I guess I gotta like record all the jumps. Yay, good for you, man. Oh, you mean when something works, you say, I've got mail? That's awesome. I like that. That's a great. That's your victory cry is I've got mail. I've got mail. Yes, I've got mail. That's right. I got mail. Okay. You know what? It might have been this. Let's take off that extra angle. Yeah, no, it's not the extra angle. He's still doing it. Okay, so what I need to do here is record all these and try and figure it out. So, oh wait, I already had this jump away from exits thing. Oh, this might be it. I forgot I was trying to do that. Oh yeah, cool. Hopefully that's it. Duh, it's like staring me right in the face the whole time. Please be it. I just want to see him jump all over the screen and never jump off the screen, except for maybe a little bit, but not too much. Oh, man. Yeah. Damn. Okay. All right. Well, yep, I guess I'm just going to log it and figure out what's going on by logging, you know, because I don't want to set a breakpoint here because I'm not going to be able to see it in real time that fast, but logging it in this case is actually a good idea. So, okay, let's actually save the quadrant that it's finding it's in too. Is the quadrant relative to the starting point? No, it's relative to the lower left of the screen. Good question, Dr. Resum. So, okay, I want to see the entity's position. The quadrant that they're in. Quiad. The angle that it chose based on that quadrant. And the vector that it ended up creating based on that angle. Okay. So the position is E dot position dot pause dot X. We want to make sure that it's being cast into a float for this particular incident because this is a custom class. I'm using the positions. All right, and then quadrant Q, and I want that to be to stir. And the angle and the vector. All right, we should be good to go. So I'll track all these and then we'll see, we should be able to see that what's going on based on just looking at the log. And then after that, after I fix this, I'm gonna have to close down the stream because I'm starving. All I had was a salad like an hour or two ago. Can you believe that? Eating a salad and getting hungry. Okay, there, we already saw him jumping off the screen, so. Oh, but what? He never appears off the screen. That's so weird. It might be a ZXL, actually. Oh, it might just appear that he's jumping off the screen. If I set ZXL to 0 and run it again, maybe he's actually not jumping off the screen. No, see, it's not the position. I don't think it's a, well, I don't, that could be slow excellence. I don't know. Just make the jump shorter. Oh yeah. See, it was that he was actually jumping up in the air. Oh, okay. So it was just a Z acceleration. It seemed like he was off the screen. So if I set that to be like half the Z acceleration. Yeah, see some of those jumps. Oh. Yeah, I think he's all right. I think he's actually jumping on the screen. What am I gonna eat? Good question. Maybe a peanut butter and jelly or something? Don't know. Okay, I'm calling this good. He's gonna jump like crazy, but he will be on the screen, I think. Actually, you know what? Let's set his jump so he's not quite so jumpy. I mean, he doesn't quite jump as often, so that we can just see. Let's do 0.618 for his jump. Yes, yeah, totally, Dr. Razum. That would really help, right? And I had the code working that way for a minute. Or at least I know the player's shadow works. Or maybe it's just, maybe I didn't actually work with the player. You know what? Maybe I'd never actually fix that. Let's do that right now. Yeah, let's do that right now. Good point, Dr. Razum. That would totally show that this is correctly working. So I think I did it with the reflection, but I forgot to do it with the shadow. So let's go to the shadow where we move shadow. There's a function called move shadow. It would be almost exactly like this right here. If the shadow is not empty, then set the shadow sprite position based on twice the Z. What type of laundry detergent do I prefer? Anything that does not have any smell. I like unscented, man. Totally. What about you? This is a little bit more complex, actually. This is for each shadow. Eyes less than shadow num sprites. I plus plus. Oh, I'd say about halfway to Josh Peck. I don't even know who Josh Peck is. Who is that? You wash your clothes in the creek behind your house? All right. Hopefully that works. So when he jumps, we'll see his shadow actually. Move a lot. And it actually would really help to set the opacity of the shadow down a bit too. Yeah, nice. That's so awesome. Oh, you know what? So what's happening is he jumps while he's already jumping, and that's what gives him the double height. Yeah, totally, Dr. Razum, right? That really helped. So I need to add a behavior that says if the Z. Beginning Java book recommendations? I don't know. But I've heard some great things about learn code the hard way. So learn. He's learned code the hard way. And then they have like a book on almost every language. Do they have a Java book? Don't know if they have Java. Dude, you're out of luck, man. I don't know. I don't know. I don't know if I don't know, man. Sorry. I don't really know Java. I've never really learned Java. Does anybody else know a good Java book? Totally, plus one for visual debugging. That totally helped. And that totally helped me realize what the heck was going on with that double jump too. So, oh, you know what? An easy way to do this would be to just go to the where, go back to that behavior of the jump and just make it so if the player or this entity is already jumping, then just return false. So if e dot move dot z excel. Nah, we'll do e dot position dot pause dot z is greater than 0. Return false. Sometimes you take a beer into the shower. Sometimes I take a coconut water into the shower. I love coconut water. Oh, it's so good. I think I've taken a beer in the shower before too, man. Nice crispy cold beer, hot shower, good combo. Nice. Okay, now he's not double jumping anymore. Yeah, so one more thing I can do to really improve this would be to make it so his shadow gets less opacity based on how high it is. But for that, I'll need to work it into the system a little bit more. He looks so happy when he just jumps again. I love it. To each his own, right? To each his own. I want to check that later on. And okay, so I'm just going to get things ready back to how they were. So this is kind of playable now. You know what that tastes like? Cool. So I'm putting back in the hoppers. And I'm gonna go and set the world so it creates a bunch of these jitter guys. Let's do four of them. 4 plus 3. There we go. So this will be about how it will be playing it like this. Yeah, so this is it. I'm gonna show the game one last time, and then I'm gonna close the stream down for tonight. It's been some good laughs though. Thanks, Glade Plugins, and everybody else too for your great comments and everything. Helping with the art today. So there, we've got some. Oh, I can't even kill him. That's right. Yeah, so I gotta work on these guys a little bit more. I forgot to set their mask so you can hit them. But they seem like a pretty cool enemy. There's some more of them on this screen. And this screen. Let's make them killable first. That's awesome. The ocean floor? How far down? Oh yeah, they need the mask so that they are a foe. Like Drolete. Yeah, it should be just foe, shot, top hat, shot, friend. Yeah, right? That's quite a task, man. Fertilizing your pet whales. I don't know why you can't hurt him. Unless they don't even have a collision box. Oh, they definitely have a collision box because I could run into them. Man, what the heck's going on? I don't know. I'm going to have to take a look at that later in detail. So yeah, that's it for today's stream. There you go. Google Fiber is finding its way all over the world. Now on the ocean floor. They should advertise that. All right, guys. Well, that's it for today's stream of Songbringer. I've been making a new enemy here, this little popping guy. And he turned out all right, but I still got some work to do. I need to get him so I can actually hit him, for example. But, yeah, I'll be back tomorrow, same time. I'm always about 4 p.m. Pacific time that I start. So, yeah, thanks for watching, you guys. Have a great night. Enjoy yourselves. And don't do anything I wouldn't do. Definitely do stuff that Glade Plugins would do, though. He sounds like he's living an amazing life.